Afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Smita from Additional Chemistry Program. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce Srimati Deepthi M. Pisharedi. Srimati Deepthi M. Pisharedi is an assistant professor in computer science from Prajyot Niketan College, Pudukkottai. She has completed her MSc and currently involved in research activities. She has more than 13 years of experience in this field. She has a lot of publications in her credit. On behalf of the Department of Higher Education and Additional Skill Acquisition Program, I welcome you, ma'am. We are really honored to have you here with us in this session. Today, I will be handling the topic Transmission Media, Wired and Wireless in first module of MSc paper and second module of BSc paper. This topic comes under subjects, computer networks, for second semester MSc Computer Science and Fundamentals of System Software, Networks and DBMS for complementary paper in BSc Computer Science. Before starting, let me explain the time allotted for each session. We have a total of session which is split into two halves. Each half will have 20 minutes of the class followed by 10 minutes of question answer session. Candidates can use the question and answer tab, which is available at the bottom of the screen for posting the questions or doubts. Also, a panel of questions to record the feedback of the participants. So participants are requested to attend the same or attend the feedback session very actively. Now let's begin. Handing over to you, ma'am.
Okay. A warm good afternoon to all. I thank all the authorities of ESAB webinar series for giving me one more chance to present today's afternoon session. Today's session is on the topic transmission media. And the contents that I wish to cover today is an introduction to transmission media, wired transmission media, wireless transmission media. Under wired transmission media, we shall try to cover twisted pair, coaxial cable, and fiber optics. And under wireless transmission media, we will cover radio transmission, microwave transmission, and infrared communication. So, what is transmission media? Actually, transmission media is a communication channel that carries information from a sender to receiver. And the data that is transmitted from sender to receiver will be in the form of electromagnetic signals. Either it will be in the form of radio signal, either it will be in the form of digital signal or microwave signals, etc. So the transmission media is just a carrier that carries information from X to Y. It can be either wired transmission media or wireless transmission media. And yesterday we have seen the ISO/ISI reference model or TCP/IP reference model. There is only one layer that has direct contact with this physical medium or this transmission medium, and that is physical layer in case of ISO/ISI reference model and host to network layer in case of TCP/IP reference model. So transmission media can be broadly classified into two, guided media and unguided media. Guided media can be again called as wired media or bounded media, whereas unguided media can be called as unbounded media, wireless media, etc. And this wireless media can be again classified as coaxial cable, fiber optics, twisted pair. These three cables comes under this guided media. And under unguided media comes radio wave transmission, microwave transmission, as well as infrared transmission. We can classify twisted pair again into two, shielded twisted pair and unshielded twisted pair. And we can classify coaxial cables as baseband coaxial cables as well as broadband coaxial cable. So what's the difference between this guided media and unguided media? In case of guided media, there is actually a wired communication or there's a communication with the help of wire between sender and receiver. But in case of wireless media or unguided media, there is no wired communication. We'll use either satellite or some antennas to transmit data between a sender and receiver. And the data will be in the form of some electromagnetic signals. And what are the factors that does need to be considered while choosing a media, either wired or wireless? The most important factor is bandwidth. Once transmission impairment, interference, these two other two factors, if they remain constant, the quality of data transmission will depend purely on bandwidth. When we say greater the bandwidth, higher will be the data transmission rate possible through that channel. So greater the bandwidth, higher data transmission rate of a signal. That's one factor that need to be considered. And the second factor is something related to quality. That is transmission impairment. When I send hello, I should be sure that the receiver also received that same signal with the same quality. If some problem happens to the quality of signal, if the quality of signal has been degraded, we can say some transmission impairment has happened there. When the received signal is not identical to the transmitted signal due to some transmission problems, we say some transmission impairment has happened. That means the quality of signal has been degraded due to many factors. Sometimes some characters has been lost or some signals has been lost. And due to this, transmission impairments may happen. So that factor is also to be considered while choosing a transmission medium. And the third factor is interference. Interference is nothing but some disturbance or some noise. So interference can be defined as the process of disrupting a signal when it travels over a communication media by addition of some unwanted signal. When some noise gets attached to our signal, suppose now I'm delivering some audio to you. If some noise gets attached to the signal, the quality of the audio signal will degrade. So that is what is meant by interference. So these three factors need to be considered for a good transmission media. Now we'll see guided transmission media in detail. And I had told earlier, in case of guided transmission media or wired transmission media, there's a physical channel or wired path between sender and receiver. And one of the most common wired transmission media or guided transmission media is twisted pair. So twisted pair is the least expensive transmission media and is most widely used. Early telephone communications were all connected by using this twisted pair. And what does this twisted pair? As shown in this figure, a twisted pair cable consists of two pairs twisted in this form. Twisting in this particular form, we'll call it as a helical arrangement. So a twisted pair, characteristics of physical arrangement is like so. It consists of pairs of wires which are twisted and arranged. And these wires are normally copper wires, which is very 1 millimeter thick. That's a normal configuration. So the physical description of twisted pairs is as follows. It consists of two insulated copper wires. And these two insulated copper wires are twisted in a helical form. And this shape that is shown in this figure is called helical form. And why we need to twist this pair? Why can't we keep two wires parallelly? The twisting is done to avoid electromagnetic interferences or to avoid unwanted noises or disturbances. And these wires are not kept all twisted as it is. These copper materials are not twisted. There's a protective shield or there's insulation outside this copper wire before we are doing twisting. And when we consider a twisted tag cable, there will be many twisted pairs like this. You can see there's a one blue color twisted pair, yellow color, then maroon color and a green color. So when we consider a twisted pair cable, we'll have a bunch of pairs twisted in this form. This is the most common and least expensive form of wire transmission media. And the main factor to be considered is its physical description. The pairs are in a twisted form and it is made of copper wires. And based on the shield used, we can classify twisted pairs into two: unshielded twisted pair and shielded twisted pair. What is the difference between these two? An unshielded twisted pair generally compromises of wires and insulators. There will be wires just covered with insulation, and a pair of wires will be in a twisted form. Whereas shielded twisted pair have a braided wired mesh that encases each pair of insulated wires. The figure is shown now. In case of shielded twisted pair, you can see there are few pairs of wires and there is no outer shield or covering for them. But in case of, that's the case of unshielded twisted pair. In case of shielded twisted pair, you can see there's a braided covering outside each pair of twisted pair. And again, we can classify this shielded twisted pair in, based on quality. That is, many categories are the 5, 5A6, 6A7 and so on. That is based on the quality of this braided mesh, wired mesh used. So that's about types of twisted pair. We can classify twisted pairs into two: shielded twisted pair and unshielded twisted pair. If there is some braided mesh covering, it is called as shielded twisted pair. If there is no such covering, we'll call as unshielded twisted pair. So from this, which will be more reliable? It will be obviously shielded twisted pair. And what are the applications where this twisted pair is used? Twisted pairs can be used in the transmission of both analog and digital signals. It is used in early telephone networks, in DSL lines, and in LAN cabling. These are the few applications where twisted pairs are commonly used. And what are connectors used with the twisted pair cabling? We need some connector to connect this wire with our device, either with our laptop or desktop or with our modem, etc. The connector that is commonly used to connect a twisted pair with the twisted pair cables with devices are RJ45 connector. It's the most commonly used connector to connect a twisted pair cable with the device. And the figure of RJ45 cable is shown here. There's a pinout or structure of that RJ45 jack. RJ stands for registered jack. And these are few transmission characteristics of twisted pair. And when day by day inventions or discoveries, inventions are going on these transmission media, so these transmission characteristics may vary when we look on day by day Google statistics and all. Normally, a twisted pair can be used to transmit both analog data as well as digital data. But the problem is that when this data transmit for a short distance, its quality began to degrade a little bit. So what we need is, in between, we need to keep some boosters to enhance the quality of signal. For that, if we are transmitting some analog data through a twisted pair cable, we need to keep amplifiers between 5 to 6 kilometers. So amplifiers will accept the signals coming through the transmission media. It will amplify the signal. Amplify the signal means it will just strengthen the signal. so that its energy doesn't get degraded while traveling a long distance. But in case of digital transmission, in between 2 to 3 kilometers, we need to keep a device called repeater. Repeaters will accept the digital data coming through the transmission media, and repeaters will repeat the data. Repeat means digital data will be in the form of ones and zeros or high low pulses. It will receive this data and it will re-inform this data. It will again create the same pattern once more and will transmit to the destination. So the purpose of this amplifiers and repeaters is to enhance the quality of data while transmitting data over a long distance. Some other characteristics of twisted pair is the bandwidth. It support in bandwidth in this range to 50 megahertz to 600 megahertz. And the loss factor, how much data is lost during transmission, is moderate. It is somewhat resistant to noise. And the data rate, minimum standard is 4 Mbps. And the most important aspect of twisted pair is cheaper. And connections can be done in between using some soldering technique. But the problem is with the security. Through tapping, someone can tap the data or can accept data during the transmission. Attenuation is moderate. Attenuation also means some disturbances or unwanted signals added to the original signal. So these are the few transmission characteristics of twisted pair. And what are the advantages and disadvantages of using this? I've already told, twisted pair is a cheap cable, and installation of unshielded twisted pair is very easy compared to shielded twisted pair. It can be even used to set up high speed LAN. And the problem or disadvantage with this cabling or this twisted pair usage is good if the transmission area is very less. For a shorter distance transmission, twisted pair cabling is good. But for a longer distance transmission, it can cause some disturbance. Although we have added amplifiers or repeaters, it can cause some attenuation or noises. So that is about twisted pair cable. Then comes second, guided transmission media, coaxial cable. Coaxial cable, the structure of coaxial cable as shown in this figure. A coaxial cable has an inner core, which is a copper conductor for transmitting signal. And this is covered by an inner insulator. And again, this insulator is closely woven by a braided metal outer conductor. And the purpose of this conductor, outer conductor, is to shield the inner core. There's an inner core which is covered by an inner insulator, which is surrounded by a braided outer conductor. And the purpose of this braided outer conductor is to shield the inner core against noise so that we can transmit data without much noise. And again, the entire case is protected by an outer protecting shield, which is normally a plastic material. So this is a general structure of a coaxial cable. There is no twisting like twisted pair in case of coaxial cable. The structure is like this. There will be an inner conductor to conduct data or transmit data, covered by an inner insulator. Then comes an outer braided metal sheet, which is used to protect the data from noises, which again, the whole system is covered by a plastic protective cover. And we'll see the transmission characteristics. This figure is a connector that is used to connect a coaxial cable to our device. The transmission characteristics, compared to twisted pair, coaxial cable has better shielding. There are two, we can see that there are two cases to protect data. And for digital transmission, normally we use a 50 ohm cable. And for analog transmission or cable television transmission or internet transmission, we use 75 ohm cable. That's a standard cable used for analog as well as digital transmission. And the bandwidth quality or cable quality or signal to noise ratio is much more compared to twisted pair for a coaxial cable. So it supports higher bandwidth transmission. Since a bandwidth rate, it's a higher bandwidth, the data transmission rate is higher. Therefore, the cable quality is more and high signal to noise ratio. Signal to noise ratio is a parameter to check the quality of signal compared with noises. And since it has a having more signal to noise ratio, the noise immunity is more for a coaxial cable. It can be used for long distance telephone systems, but cost is greater compared to twisted pair. But compared to twisted pair, security is more for a coaxial cable. And we use special connectors as shown in this figure for connecting a coaxial cable to our device. It can transmit data over several thousands of kilometers. So these are a few characteristics of data transmission while using coaxial cable. And as told earlier, coaxial cable can be classified into two: baseband transmission coaxial cable as well as broadband transmission coaxial cable. What's the difference between these two? A baseband transmission can be defined as transmitting a signal at high speed. If you see this figure, there's a baseband transmission media where a single signal is transmitted at very high speed. No multiple signal transmission through a channel. Single signal is transmitted at very high speed. This is normally used for digital transmission. Whereas broadband transmission coaxial cable or broadband transmission means process of transmitting multiple signals simultaneously. Here we can see three signals are transmitted through this channel simultaneously. So based on type of transmission, either transmitting a single signal at a time or transmitting multiple signals at a time, we can classify coaxial cable as broadband transmission coaxial cable or baseband transmission coaxial cable. What are the applications of coaxial cable? A coaxial cable is used in some analog telephone networks. It can be used in digital telephone networks, and most common users used in cable TV networks. And traditional Ethernet LANs are connected using coaxial cable for MAN connectivity. Not only for LAN connectivity, for MAN connectivity too, we can use coaxial cable, because cable TV networks are best example of a MAN, metropolitan area network. So to connect cable TV network to various houses or to transmit data through a cable TV, we can use coaxial cables. The advantages and disadvantages of using coaxial cable. Advantages are the bandwidth is more, so data transmission speed is more. The data can be transmitted at a higher speed. And told earlier, it has a better shielding than twisted pair cable. It provides higher bandwidth. And the main disadvantage compared to coaxial cable is, as told earlier, it is a little bit costlier than twisted pair cable. Next comes fiber optics. Fiber optics is also a wired transmission media, but using fired optics, data is transmitted in form of light pulses. So what is fiber optic? Fiber optic is a cable that holds optical fibers. Fiber optic cable may contain many optical fiber cables like this, which is coated with plastic material. These optical fiber cables are coated with plastic material and they are used for data transmission. But here, data is transmitted by pulses of light or as light pulses. And what is the purpose of this plastic coating? The purpose of plastic coating in the optical fiber is to protect the optical fibers from heat, cold, electromagnetic interferences, etc. And the fiber optic cable can transmit data at a higher speed than copper wires. Reason is that it is transmitting data in form of light and the transmission speed of light is very high. Optical fibers are transparent and they are flexible fibers and they are mainly made up of either glass or plastic material, and these materials will allow transmission of data in form of light waves. We'll see the structure of optical fiber. Optical fiber consists of mainly three parts. A core part is the cladding part is the and an outer jacket is the. And this figure have described, I will be describing two parts, core and cladding. In the coming slide, we will discuss about the jacket part. And the core part is the innermost part of a fiber optic cable. This is a core part. And it is this part that will transmit or propagate light waves. It is normally cylindrical in shape and it is made of flexible glass, and the refractive index property of this core part is high compared to the cladding part. The reason we will come across later. So core is cylindrical in shape, it is made of flexible glass and it has a flexible glass of high refractive index. It is called, this core part is normally called optical waveguide. Why are we calling it as an optical waveguide? Since this is a channel that transmit light signals. Since this channel or this part is transmitting light signals, we are calling it as optical waveguide. So that's about core part. Core part is the innermost part and this part transmit data in form of light waves or light pulses. Outside the core comes the part cladding. The core is surrounded by cladding, which is a glass material. And the property of this glass or cladding is that its refractive index is lower compared to the refractive index of core. The reason is that when a light wave is transmitted from an area to other with two refractive indexes, a total internal reflection will happen. This is how, see this figure, in this figure, this is how light waves are transmitting through a coaxial cable. In a zigzag manner, that is, a light wave will touch a boundary, it will bounce. When it touches some other boundary, it will again bounce. And this pattern, light waves are transmitted through this core part. And this type of transmission is called total internal reflection. Light waves are reflected, and transmitted. And for this total internal reflection, we need two areas of two refractive index. For that, we have a core part with higher refractive index and an outer cladding part of lower refractive index. So this refractive index property enables total internal reflection of light waves through the core. And this total internal reflection, the light waves are transmitted from center to receiver through the core. The next part, outside part, is called jacket. And here also I have shown a figure of optical fiber with two parts, core, cladding, and an outer coating. And the outer part is called outer coating or jacket. The purpose of this part is to protect the inner part. The outer jacket is again a thin plastic sheath or coating, and that is opaque to light, not transparent, an opaque part. It prevents light rays from outside to enter the optical fiber. The light rays from outside enter this optical fiber, we are transmitting data in form of light rays. So these two will collide. So in order to protect the inner part from outside, this outer coating or jacket is used. The main purpose is to prevent the light rays from entering to the optical fiber. So these are three main parts of an optical fiber: core, cladding, and a jacket. And connection of optical fiber. This GIF image will show you how total internal reflection or how data transmission happens inside the core. See, the light waves are transmitting by total internal reflection through the core part. And connection, to connect these optical fibers again to our device, to our laptop or modem, we can use three types of connectors. They are subscriber channel connector, which is shown in this first figure. This is mainly used in cable TV connections. Second one is straight tip connector or ST connector, which is used for connecting to network devices. And there is an empty RJ connector, which is similar to RJ connector used in twisted pair. So these three are the most common connectors used. And we will see how data is transmitted as a light through this optical fiber from a transmitter to receiver or from a sender to receiver. For this, there are few main components in this transmission, a few main devices. There is a transmitter circuitry, a light source, and a detector for this light source. And at receiver also, we have a receiver circuit. The transmitter will send whatever data we want to send. It can be either in form of analog or digital. And before sending this data to this optical fiber cable, we need to convert this data, input data, into light form. Normally, one is considered as presence of light, and zero as absence of light. So a light source is there to convert input data to light form or as light pulses, optical pulses. Once this data is transmitted through optical fibers and as it reaches the receiver, there's a detector to receive this light pulses, and this light pulses in the receiver will be converted to form, either digital or analog form, by the circuit there. So this is how data transmission is done. Input data at the transmitter side will be converted to light waves, and by this total internal reflection, the data will be transmitted through the core part of optical fiber, and it will reach the receiver. Once it is reached at the receiver, this light rays will be converted back to the original signal form. So that is what told in this slide, how data is transmitted through an optical fiber. Now, what are the propagation modes of transmission through this optical fiber? This light rays can be transmitted in different ways, and based on the propagation modes, we can classify it as single mode and multi-mode. In a single mode, it is a single strand of glass fiber that allows only one beam to be transmitted or propagated at a time. The last one is an example of a single mode. Here, only a single light ray is transmitted at a time. But in multi-mode, multiple beams of light sources are transmitted at a time. And this multi-mode again can be step-indexed or multi-mode, and those figures are given. Step-index mode is also there and graded based on the pattern of total internal reflection. So these two are the propagation mode, single mode and multi mode. What are the applications of fiber optics? Fiber optics is again used in telephone systems, submarine cable networks. It is used in to data link computer networks, CATV systems, CCTV cameras, for connecting police, fire and other emergency services. They can be used in many industrial uses and can be used in some construction sites also. Applications you can go through. Now, advantages of using this fiber optic cable. It has greater bandwidth compared to a twisted pair and coaxial cable. Greater the bandwidth, higher will be the data transmission rate. So next advantage, faster speed. The reason for faster speed is we are transmitting data in form of light. Light signals are transmitted at a greater speed. And it can be used in longer distance transmission compared to our coaxial cable and twisted pair. It is more reliable than the copper cables because the temperature changes may not much affect this fiber optics cable. But when the copper cables are more exposed to temperature changes, they may get damaged. And this cable is so thinner and sturdier. That's also an advantage of using coaxial cable. Now we'll see a few questions. I think we'll just go through the questions. You can just write it out in your mind or in a paper in your hands. Discuss answers also. I'll just give one or two or fraction of seconds to answer a question. Transmission media lie below which layer in the ISO/ISI reference model? The options are based on ISO/ISI reference model. Transmission media lie below dash layer. The next question is, dash cable consists of an inner copper core and second conducting outer sheath. Which cable has an inner copper core which is covered by a second conducting outer sheath? Next question is, dash cable can carry signals at higher frequency ranges than dash cable. See the option. Which cables can be compared based on their frequency ranges? The next is, the innermost core of an optical fiber is dash in composition. It's made of what material? I hope all of you can answer it. And what's a major factor that makes coaxial cable less susceptible to noise than the twisted pair cable? We'll quickly go through the answer. The transmission media lie below which layer? Physical layer. Dash cable consists of an inner copper core and a second conducting outer sheath. That's coaxial cable. Copper, that term need to be considered. And coaxial cable carry signals of higher frequency range than twisted pair. The inner core of an optical fiber is made of glass or plastic material. So composition is glass or plastic. Then what's a major factor that makes coaxial cable less susceptible to noise than the twisted pair, the outer conductor? So I think these are something that we need to cover in the guided media. Then we can go quickly to next category, wireless transmission or unguided medium or unbound medium. Here there is no physical path or wired path between sender and receiver. I think all are alive though. So wireless transmission, what's the need of this wireless transmission? It's very difficult to run wires or physical cables when there are some obstacles like mountains, jungles, oceans, etc. So in such situation, wireless transmission forms can be used for transmitting data. And as told earlier, wireless transmission involves no physical link between two or more devices. They are communicated by some wireless media. And wireless signals are transmitted through air. And for sending and receiving, we may need some mechanism. Normally, antennas are used to send data and receive data. So antennas will radiate the waves in the form of electromagnetic waves or electromagnetic energy. In the receiving side also, there will be antennas to pick this data. And the transmission can be either directional. Directional means data will be transmitted only in a direction, or omnidirectional, can be transmitted in various directions. And first wireless transmission media is radio transmission. Radio waves have omnidirectional antennas. That means antennas that can send signals in all directions. And radio transmission is popular because radio waves are easier, or radio waves are easier to generate. And they can travel long distance. Radio frequency is easier to generate, as told earlier, and they can travel in a larger wavelength. They can even penetrate through obstacles like wall-like structures. So that is why radio transmission has become popular. And what are the properties of radio waves according to their frequency factors? Low frequency radio waves can pass through the obstacles very well, and they have ground propagation. They can transmit through or penetrate through walls, and they are normally said to have ground propagation. Power falls, but when they travel through a larger distance, their power gradually falls off. Whereas high frequency radio waves normally have a straight line transmission, and they are said to have a sky propagation. Low frequency is said to have a ground propagation, and high frequency is said to have a sky propagation. However, they are affected by interferences, and they are very well affected by atmospheric characters like rain, atmospheric changes like rains, etc. And when they reach some obstacle, they will bounce back. That is why they are told to have a straight line transmission. And even though we are using low frequency radio wave or high frequency radio wave, any form is affected by interferences from motor or electric equipment. Lower frequencies are normally of VLF, very low frequency, MF bands, can travel up to, travel on the ground up to 1,000 kilometers on the Earth's surface. So there's a figure showing the transmission of a radio wave on the Earth's surface. Whereas high frequency radio waves such as HF and VHF bands are spread upward. But when these band touches the ionosphere, they are reflected back to the Earth. This figure shows how a radio wave is transmitted. Once it touches the atmosphere, it will be radiated back. The applications of radio wave, it can be used for broadcasting and multicasting. You have heard about radio transmission and all. And it's used in fixed and mobile radio communications, AM and FM radio transmission, television communication. It can be used in marine communication, and our wireless computer networks are connected with the help of radio waves. Cordless phones work with the help of radio waves. So these are the few applications of use of radio wave. Advantages of radio wave. Radio transmission is mainly used for wide area networks and mobile cellular phone communication. Radio waves cover a larger area, and they can penetrate through the wall. So it's an advantage. And when it comes to microwave, they can transmit only in a straight line. Radio transmission provides a higher transmission rate. And next comes the microwave. Next, wireless transmission medium. Microwave transmission can be again classified as terrestrial microwave transmission and satellite microwave transmission. Terrestrial microwave transmission. Here, electromagnetic waves, electromagnetic microwaves are used to transmit data and they travel in straight line. Because microwaves travel in straight line, the antennas in the center and receiver must be aligned in a straight line. Here in this figure, you can see the antennas are aligned in a straight line. So for a long distance transmission, what we need to do? We need to align multiple antennas in between to carry this signal from center to receiver. This figure showing how data is transmitted through antenna. And what are the features of microwave transmission? Microwaves travel in straight line as told earlier. So the transmitter and receiver stations should have antennas that are properly aligned. And microwave propagation is called a line of sight propagation. So the hosting station should be placed so that the curvature of earth or any obstacles does not interfere the communication. And it is unidirectional. It allows multiple receivers in a row to receive data without interference. And microwaves do not pass through buildings. So we cannot keep any antennas indoor. And another property is microwaves are often refracted by atmospheric layers. The refracted rays take no longer time to reach the destination than the direct rays. The refracted rays will take longer time to reach the destination than the direct rays. And this causes an out-of-phase transmission. This out-of-phase transmission is called multipath fading. And there are two categories of microwave antenna, parabolic dish antenna and horn antenna. Parabolic dish antenna is normally used in the receiving station, whereas horn antenna is normally used in the sending station. So parabolic dish antenna, as told earlier, it is used in the receiving station and shape is, it's in the shape of parabola. It is parabolic in shape so that it can concentrate. Since it is in the shape, it can exit all each and every waves coming to it, which concentrate all energy to a small beam, thus achieving a stronger signal to noise ratio. Whereas in sending station, we can use horn antennas, which is curved head, where outgoing waves from the stem are broadcasted by a curved head as a series of parallel beams. In sending station, the signals transmit on parallel beams, but in receiving side, this coming signal need to be accepted in a curvature form. The receiving stations, these are collected by the curved head and deflected in the stem. Even horn antennas can be used in the receiving side also. The applications are, it is used in television communication, telecommunication systems, and some point-to-point links between buildings. Advantages of microwave, it is cheaper. We need no cabling and no need to acquire land to do this kind of cabling. And microwave transmission provides an easy communication in terrains or in mountain area where installation of cable is difficult. Communication overseas can be achieved using microwave transmission. Disadvantages are eavesdropping, and eavesdropping create an insecure communication. That is, someone in between can capture the signals coming from the center. That's a drawback. And as told earlier, there's a multipath folding problem, out-of-phase signals. A signal can be moved out of phase by using a microwave transmission. It is very much susceptible to the weather condition. Rain, wind, etc. can distort the signal. And allocation of bandwidth is limited for a microwave transmission. These are the few disadvantages. Next comes a satellite communication. A satellite communication uses a physical object called satellite for data transmission. And satellites are objects that are placed above the atmosphere. It's a physical object that revolves around the Earth at a known height. Satellite communication is more reliable communication nowadays as it is more flexible than cabling system. And we can communicate with anyone at any part of the globe using the satellite communication. And how does a satellite communication works? For a satellite communication, we need to keep a satellite transporter in the atmosphere, and data is sent from a ground station to the satellite transporter. Satellite transporter will receive this data, will modify the data or will regenerate the data, and will send back to a ground station. That is how satellite transmission process is working. And data is sent from a ground station to the satellite using a particular frequency. That frequency is called uplink frequency. Data transmission from a ground station to the satellite using an uplink frequency, whereas the rebroadcasted data from the satellite or retransmitted data from satellite to the ground station is using downlink frequency. Normally, the satellite transporters will receive data and they will amplify the data. For the advantages, the coverage area of a satellite is much more than the other transmission media. And once implemented, the transmission cost is very less. For a satellite communication, the cost is mainly for the implementation. Once implemented, the transmission cost is less. It is widely used in mobile and wireless communication application. And although the satellite installation is tough, the receiving of signal or transmission of signal is easy. And it is widely used in many applications like weather forecasting, radio or TV signal broadcasting, mobile communications, etc. nowadays. But still it has disadvantage. I told the designing of satellite and development of a satellite require more time. And the working of satellite need to be monitored and controlled regularly. And normally there's a lifespan for a satellite. Suppose if the lifespan is 12 to 15 years, once it is the lifespan is about to expire, we need to plan to manufacture a new satellite and launch a new satellite. So these are the disadvantages of using microwave communication. Next comes the last one, infrared communication. And infrared transmission again uses a wireless technology to transmit data. But this technology can be used to transmit data in a very short distance. That is to transmit data from a TV remote to TV. So in that short range only, we can use this infrared communication. And the frequency of infrared is ranged from 3 gigahertz to 400 hertz. It is used for very short range communication such as data transfer between two cell phones, TV remote operation, data transfer between a computer and cell phone, etc. The characteristics of infrared, it supports higher bandwidth. Therefore, data rate speed is very high. And infrared waves cannot penetrate through the walls, but it provides better security. Since data is transmitted between very short distance, there may not be any interference in between, and then no one will be there to interfere our data. And infrared communication is unreliable outside the building. To transmit data from one building to other, infrared communication is not reliable. Because outside the building, there will be sun rays. These sun rays may interfere with our infrared wave. So these are the main characteristics of an infrared transmission. And we'll see a few more questions very fastly and we'll wind up the session. Dasha used for short range
communication. Excuse me, ma'am. Okay. Which one is more secured, wired or wireless? And why is it more secured for data transmission?
Actually, every transmission media has its own security issues. A wireless may be secure if you are using infrared beams, as I told in the last part of the session, because there we are transmitting data to a shorter distance. The longer distance we are transmitting data, it is easy for some intruders to intrude to our data or to interfere into our data. So there are security issues in both wired and wireless.
Once again, ma'am, is coaxial communication serial?
Yes.
Will the throughput be better than that of twisted pair?
In coaxial cable, we have baseband and broadband. In case of baseband, only a single signal can be transmitted at a time. So in such situation, normally we use serial communication. In other cases, in case of sending a video, we can use a broadband type coaxial cable transmission. What data is sent as a part, audio is sent as a part, and video is sent as a part. So video or images can be transmitted as a third part. So here, three categories of data are transmitting parallelly. And in such situation, it is much better than twisted pair. No doubt in that.
FTOHM coaxial cable is used for analog and not for digital. Similarly, why set?
That's a normal standard that we see.
Can be used for.
Okay. That's a normal standard that we see in textbooks, and I don't know much about that.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. One more question by Joni Jos. So she, what do you mean by grand propagation in wireless transmission?
Grand propagation. Sorry.
Ground spelling. Propagation. Sorry, ma'am.
Okay, ground propagation. Ground propagation. Is it ground propagation?
Yes,
that means data is transmitted just in straight line. We are not transmitting data to some atmospheric layers.
So ma'am, it's time for winding up. So and candidates, these questions will be answered due to time restriction. Thank you so much, ma'am, such for an informative session explaining the various wire and wireless in a very detailed manner. And we would like five sessions with you, ma'am. So I would also like to thank all the participants present here for the active participation and the valid questions. And thank you. Thank you. See you in the next session. Ma'am, would you like to add something?
Thank you. And there were a few more questions just for a quizzing. And I think I will just scroll through those so that the attendees can just watch if the time permits. Just need fraction of seconds. Can I? Yeah, these were the few questions that I prepared based on wireless transmission. We'll go directly to the answers and question. Dash are used for short-range communications between a PC and a peripheral device. It is infrared wave. Sorry. When a beam of light travels through a media of two different densities and if the angle of incidence is greater than critical angle, dash occurs. Reflection, that's a principle used in fiber optics. Microwaves are unidirectional. Dash media transport electromagnetic waves without use of physical conductor, unguided. And thank you. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to conduct this session. Thank you very much.